bishop without being religious. It's written by a Methodist bishop, Methodist clergy. Here's what he says. It seems to me, well, let me start. The late Alfred Luckham, borrowing from Robert Frost, claimed that he carried a lifelong lover's quarrel with the church. This, it seems to me, is what every Christian, be he minister or lay, ought to do. The Christian church today is, and I suppose always has been, both glorious and ridiculous, dedicated and superficial, relevant and trivial. It behooves us then, those of us who love the church, to do what we can to eliminate the ridiculous, the superficial, and the trivial, so that the glory and the dedication and relevance may be seen unobscured. So keep that in mind as we think about priesthood. When I think of my own priesthood ordination on the Feast of the Epiphany at St. Mark's Episcopal Church in San Antonio in 1967, I remember the words of the Right Reverend Earl Dykus, Bishop Suffragan of West Texas, as he quoted from the prayer, the 1928 prayer, mind you. Ye have heard, brethren, as well as in your private examination, as in the exhortation which was now made to you, and in holy lessons taken out of the gospel, of what dignity and of how great importance this office is, and how high a dignity and how weighty a charge you are called, that is to say, to be a messenger, watchman, and steward of the Lord, to teach, to premonish, to feed and provide for the Lord's family, to seek for Christ's sheep that they are dispersed abroad, and for his children who are in the midst of this naughty world, that they may be saved through Christ forever. Now those are archaic words. And our 1979 prayer book uses different language that we can understand, but it says basically the same thing, which has been said to all deacons seeking ordination to the sacred order of priests, at least since the ordinal of 1550 in the Church of England. Those words then today and those same lessons from Holy Writ have formed and shaped clergy for centuries. And Lisa, you are now a part of that ongoing witness of Christ to God's world and to God's children. When you were ordained deacon on January 15th of this year, you heard these words. God now calls you to a special ministry of servanthood, serving all people, particularly the poor, the weak, the sick, the lonely. And shortly, you will hear in the examination of the priesthood. Now you're called to work as a pastor, priest, and teacher, together with your bishop and fellow ministers and presbyters, and to take your share in the councils of the church. Interestingly, as you have been told, I'm sure, and certainly will experience over the lifetime of your ministry until you pass on to the great reward, that once a deacon, always a deacon. Once one who serves, always one who serves. You don't move up. You keep that service in your being. As I said, the lessons we've just heard have been used in services like this service really since medieval times. And if you think about that, that's a long time. And lots and lots of men and women have been ordained listening to those same lessons. Let me share with you some brief thoughts about our lessons and how they try to shape the priesthood through their message. Because I believe that they set in place and are the cornerstone of what this service is all about. In our song, this is the assurance of God's promise to David's offspring and to Jerusalem, of God's love and of God's promise and of God's care, then and now. In Isaiah, that's that magnificent passage that the splendor of the Lord on the throne and the writer standing before the throne. And the only thing that comes to the writer's mind is, in the midst of all this splendor, woe is me, a sinner. Humans cannot stand before God. Yet Isaiah is forgiven. Sin wiped away, and Isaiah is picked to speak the difficult truths for God. And then the Ephesians letter, probably written in prison in Rome. This epistle, or a circular letter that was passed around from churches to churches in Asia Minor, this passage offers very practical reminders for the early church and for us today. Grace given to each of you, each one of us. And Christ's gifts include, but not limited to, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. But for what purpose? For the equipment of the saints. And as we know, Paul uses that word saints to mean those followers of Jesus, those disciples. Every Christian, lay and clergy. The work of ministry, the building up of the body. We're all working together with our God-given gifts for ministry and the building up of the church. God has given each one of you all gifts. As I told the director of music, or I said to her, you're not expecting me to sing the Come Holy Ghost, because that's a gift I do not have. I have other gifts, limited number, but not that one. Each one of us has gifts. And then we also notice shortly in that epistle, part of the message quoted in the prayer of consecration that you all will hear and that I will say. It reminds us of the unity of the various ministries of the body of Christ. Not for the benefit of the one who is being ordained, but to equip the saints for the work of ministry. This reading all reminds us a valuable lesson of correctness and to the erroneous view that the priesthood really exhausts the meaning of ministry. And then we have that wonderful passage from the Gospel of John that again has come to us from at least the Middle Ages in ordination services. When I hear this passage at an ordination service to the priesthood, I cannot forget the words of the late Archbishop of Canterbury, William Temple, from his classic commentary, readings from St. John's Gospel, written in 1939. And I want to quote just a short piece of that. The function of the shepherd is to care for the sheep and to do and bear whatever is required by that care. The perfect shepherd faces death itself for the sheep if the man who holds the office exercises it for the sake of his pay, not for the sake of the sheep. He's a hireling and not a shepherd. The true test comes when he has to choose between his own interest and that of the flock. His dominant motive must be care of the flock, and nothing must ever take precedent of that. And then he goes on to say, this is the secret of all true pastors' work. It is achieved through personal acquaintance. He knows them by name. He knows their qualities. He can pray for each intelligently. The best preaching is a fruit of constant pastoral visiting, and it springs out of the relationship between pastor and people. And at last month's ordination service for Andrew Ellison and Trinity Church in Marshall, the preacher, the Reverend Dr. Nathan Jennings, a professor of liturgics at the Seminary of the Southwest, and some of you know him, said this, and I quote, "And Andrew, the good news to you is you're not the good shepherd. Jesus is, but he is with you always. You're not the good shepherd, but Jesus is, and he is there with you, next to you always." Let me just return to the service and the examination and remind us and remind Lisa of some things. As a priest, those words will come from me to say, it is your task, not Lisa. You decide what you want to do or what you'd like to do as a priest. It will be your task. It will be your task. You got the message. The ordination service uses action words, doing something specific, concrete, to proclaim. To declare, to make plain by word, by teaching and deed, by your life and your actions, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just a quick story of maybe on teaching and proclaiming, not how to do it. When I was a really bright first year seminarian at the Episcopal Theological School in Cambridge, Massachusetts, I was doing children's sermons, and it was my task on the Feast of the Epiphany to explain to these 3, 4, and 5-year-olds the meaning of Epiphany. And of course, we all know that means manifestation, showing forth. And so I began to talk to them, and I had these blank looks, because they didn't grasp manifestations. And so I said, well, epiphany is a Greek word. And I said, y'all know where Greek is, don't you? Blank stares. And so I finally kind of muddled through it, and finally I said, what does epiphany mean? One little bright guy stuck his hand up real quick, and you know, you guess it. So, it means grease on a car. Grease on a car. So I learned a terribly important lesson about teaching. You have to use the words and the images for people who can understand where they are. I served in churches in South Texas who had a number of ranchers. And I didn't use the word manifestation or anything like that. We talked about cattle. So just remember that your job is to teach the gospel. And sometimes you have to come down from the words that you learned in seminary, sadly, because we know those words. They're wonderful. But they need to be translated. And then part of the examination is that you're to love and to serve the people among whom you work, caring for all sorts. All sorts and kinds of God's children. Jesus said something about this in a parable at a dinner party. And those who were invited and they wanted to be invited and have they wanted to reciprocate the guest, the giver of the party. So it was, but that's not what Jesus did. He ministered in talking about those on the margin. And those are the kind of folks that we have to think about when we do our ministry, our sacramental ministry and priesthood. When I was called to St. Paul's Church in Waco as a young rector. It was my first week and the first few days on the job. An older gentleman made an appointment to come see me. He was a doctor. He was a physician, well known, and he made an appointment. And as you know, doctors, unlike clergy, are sometimes brief and to the point. They don't beat around the bush like clergy do. So the first thing out of his mouth as he sat down in my office, "You know, Rayford, I did not want the vestry to call you as rector. I wanted them to call Dickie. I just wanted to tell you that." And then he cut up and left. that was a wonderful question. And over the next 10 or so years, I tried, not by myself, but by the work of the Holy Spirit, to minister to him as I did everybody else in that congregation. And we became friends, and we became close. I had the privilege of having a part in the burial of his adult daughter, and later on, I officiated at his funeral. But later, a few years later, he came up to me and said, "You know, I was wrong about you." I said, under my breath, "Thank you, Jesus." But the point is that you have to love all people. I've got one quick story. There's another parishioner that always was after me and always complaining, and he always wanted to know my salary and how much I made because he felt like I was being paid more than he was. And, but I loved him to death. And he was an ultra-conservative, actually he was a state representative in Waco. And we argued about politics, but I loved him and he loved me. And that's the way we have to do with people who we don't get along with. So often in the church, we get to minister to people that we like. And the people that we don't like, we tend to shy away from, but we can't do that. And that's not what Jesus did. Because he reached out to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the religious leaders, and to those on the margin. And you are to preach. You are to preach. And since you went to the seminary that's so well known for, you know, training preachers and helping them, I'm not going to say any more about that. You're doing all right on that, I'm assuming. Because everybody from Virginia Seminary that I've ever heard has been a good preacher.
Amen.
And you have that privilege and that honor to to go into that with them. And touch their lives. And this truly is a privilege God gives you to carry out God's love and God's presence to others. And sometimes it can be a little tricky and sometimes a little difficult. This may be the last story, but maybe not. When I was a very young priest, I had just learned how to do communion, and I was taking private communion from the 1928 prayer book, and I learned the service, and I memorized the words, and the secretary at the church told me, she always told me where to go, and so I went to call on these two older ladies. They were more mature ladies, I should say, and when I got there, they were so pleased that I came, and this was right before Christmas, and they were so excited that I came, and they said, "We know that you were coming, but we were afraid you weren't going to come. We knew you weren't going to come." I said, "Oh, no, I'm a new priest. I'm asking you to do something. I'm going to be there. I'm a great pastor." So I showed up, and we talked, and they kept saying, "We just knew you weren't going to come." I said, "Okay." And I gave communion. We had a very meaningful, that was one of my very first communions, and I thought it was really very special. I was using the private communion set that my parents had given me when I was ordained. And, you know, it was a white casing, it was very shiny black, and the chalice, and it was all silver, and it wasn't, you know, tarnished, and it was just wonderful. And they finally, as I was getting ready to leave, they said, "We just knew you weren't going to come, but we're so glad you did." And I said, "I told you again that I was going to be here, and I'm glad I did." And they said, "Yes, but we were afraid you wouldn't come because we have the flu." You know, I didn't think much of that because I was young, and I was 26 years old, and I was healthy, and 3 days later, I had the Hong Kong flu, and it hurt, and it lasted 2 weeks. But sometimes in our sacramental ministry, we're called on to minister in difficult situations. You are to nourish Christ's people, not from your own strength, from your own smarts or your own abilities, and you have a lot of those, but from the riches of His grace for the building up of the kingdom of God. So Lisa, there are tasks that you're called to carry out, not alone, but with the strength and the energy of God's Holy Spirit. So if you'll stand, and this is the traditional charge, and it's short, but Lisa, always remember to pray, and you know this, and you do this, but in your busy life as a priest, and it will get busier, you have to carve out that special time for prayer, for reading God's Word, a time to talk to God, and to have God talk to you. And that can be a sacred time, and so often I get in the habit of it becomes routine. But most of the time it's not. But we have to keep doing it every day. Every time I go to the hospital room or to go to visit someone in a home, I pray a short prayer. And before I go into a meeting, I pray. Because I am helpless without prayer and without Jesus at my side as the Good Shepherd. And as Archbishop Temple said years ago, know your flock. Know your flock here. Go see them. Get to know them and their environment. On campus, wherever, in their homes or in their workplace, their recreation place on campus, social occasions. And yes, be there when they need you. Be there when they need you. I had the practice when I was in the parish ministry of calling on everyone once a year in their home, if I could catch them home. Whether I served in a small congregation of 400 or in a congregation of 11 or 1200. The larger one obviously was harder. You had to kind of be disciplined and have a plan, but it worked. So remember, that, as Archbishop Temple said, to be acquainted, to know your people. And I want to close with a quote from Joan Chittister. The Holy Spirit, God's energizing presence among us, sounds the truth in us that we are more than we seem to be. The Spirit of God moves us to new heights of understanding, to new types of witness, to new dimensions of life needed in the here and now. And that's what will continue to happen as you grow in your neighborhoods. God will call you more and more out of what you think you can do and where you think you should be into new and exciting and wonderful ministries. Bless you this day.